Breaking barriers. Breaking barriers. What barriers can't we break? Thousands of years ago, our ancestors would have never thought that we can get into this metal thing called an airplane with wings and a tail and fly to anywhere, I mean anywhere in this world. Nor did they ever think that most of us would have such artifacts of great power that we can just click and we'll light up and we can call anybody on the other side of the earth. These very artifacts, these very objects, are the evidences of human progression throughout the course of time. They're the evidence that we, as a race, have broken numerous barriers, shattered numerous boundaries, and ascended beyond numerous things that we once thought was impossible. We are a race that likes to defy the impossible. We are a race that loves to break barriers because we always want more. However, it seems a little ironic at times because we still have so many problems in this world. We still have so many barriers left to break. For example, I can't time travel or turn into a bird in this flat way. There are still things we can't do. But nonetheless, we still seek for the better. However, it's a little demoralizing at times because it feels like the farther we have gone, the farther there is left to go. So this is a problem. In order to address this problem and understand it better, we should stop asking ourselves how we can break barriers, but rather ponder, why do we form barriers in the first place? Think of it this way. If I want to buy an ice cream and I don't have the money to buy it, my inability to purchase this object that fulfills my desire becomes a barrier in my mind. However, objectively speaking, in reality, my lack of money is just merely a fact. It is not an actual barrier. It is how my mind interprets this fact that makes it into a barrier. So, when you boil it down and really think about it, the root of all these barriers, all these impossibilities we deem, are actually just ourselves. We are our biggest problem. And like my previous fellow speakers talked about a little bit, these barriers come when we want something but cannot get it so easily or immediately. Like, say, college admission or instant gratification. All those things are part of human needs, human desires. So let's look at a few more closely. First, let's talk college. As a senior right now, I can confidently reassure you that the college admission process is rather stressful. We stress because we want validation of our hard work. We want to see all of our academic life be paid off in some shape or form. And in this modern day society, in this game called college or play, the form of reward we get comes in the acceptances to highly ranked colleges, high SAT score, good grades, etc. They give us a sense, of worth. This comes back to self-esteem. We want to feel better about ourselves. We want to feel good about what we do. We want to work our asses off on something we care about and then receive recognition for it. That's part of human nature. That's not a bad thing. It is what pushes us forward. However, it can cause stress, like Lauren said, and a lot more problems. But this is a human need that we cannot deny. On the other hand, we want to meet new friends because we like friends, because we are hardwired as social creatures who enjoy the company of others. That's why we seek a sense of belonging, a sense of acceptance, a sense that we can show someone all our weaknesses, all of our imperfections, and be loved just the same. That's why we love friends, that's why we love company, and that's why we continually seek to pursue more intimate friendships, because they make us feel like we belong somewhere. It makes us feel like we are accepted somewhere. So take a look at this picture. It is called the Maslow's Hierarchy of Human Needs, proposed by an American psychologist named Abraham Maslow in 1943. As you can see on the bottom, you have the most basic human needs, the ones to maintain survival, like food, water, energy, sleep, and so on. And then as we move up, we see the needs that lead to the formation of civilization. The need to want stability, the need to want law and order. And then as we move even further above, we have the greater pursuits of mankind. A pursuit of this internal, emotional, and intangible thing that we so belovedly named happiness. We all want to be happy in life. And that's why we seek intimate relationships, friends, and a feeling of accomplishment, being recognized. And however you see, this is missing its peak, its apex. is missing the ultimate desire of mankind, a phenomenon called self-actualization. Self-actualization is essentially self-fulfillment. It is when you find what you love and you fulfill your complete potential in doing what you love. And we all seek fulfillment, like talked about in numerous novels, or literature, movies, whatever. Everybody wants to find why they are on this world, why we were created in the first place. So, some characteristics of self-actualization. The first is an efficient perception of reality. What this means, basically, is accepting things for the way they are, not being in denial of things that you don't like. As Michael Jordan once said, I can accept failures, but I cannot accept not trying. I can see my weaknesses, but I cannot accept not trying to better them. We know that we have failures. We know we have imperfections. We are not perfect creatures by any means. Therefore, we have to accept that and work on the areas that we're weak at. And then the second one is a comfortable acceptance of self or selves. It is basically understanding who you are, knowing your shortcomings, knowing where you're strong, and then loving yourself basically, like your closest ones love you. And the last one is an experience called peak experiences. It is this magical thing almost when you do something that you so sincerely enjoy that you lose a sense of time almost. You see it in professional athletes, artists, singers, and teachers, speakers, all the time. They enjoy what they do, and when they do it, they find themselves merging with the world around them, merging with time itself, merging with their own passions, merging with who they are. They become one with themselves, no longer affected by the external pressures of our world. However, the reality is, only a very few number of people can actually achieve self-actualization, because we live in a society with so many sources of pressure. Friends, family, peers, pop culture, you name it. But we don't have to be affected by them. We essentially lock ourselves away from our greatest desire. And that's ironic almost in a sense. The first thing that we use subconsciously to lock ourselves away is this thing called self-doubt. We all ask ourselves questions at times, like, am I really good enough to do this? I think someone else is better than me at this. When you doubt yourself, you start to question the potential within you. You start to ignore what you can actually do. And doubts kill more dreams than failures ever will, because doubts make you stagnant. Having self-doubt is like me standing here, wanting to walk to the other side of the stage, but never taking that first step out, because I fear I will fall and never get up again. But if I just try, even if I take the first step and I fall, and I break my leg, I can get up again. I can keep walking forward. It may take a long time to get to where I want to be, but when I look back, after the stumbles and failures, I'm far away from where I started. This is the difference between falling and getting up and not stepping forward at all. Like they always say, it's always better to have tried and failed than to have never tried at all. Next, we have our good friend, stress. Everybody likes to be stressed almost. Everybody says they're stressed. I can go to the middle school courtyard and people will say they're stressed. It's almost become a culture in the sense that we just deem any task as difficult or failing as stress. But stress, when you really think about it, is not the impossibility of the tasks we're facing, but rather the fear that we cannot dictate our own fate. Let's say I have 5 AP exams tomorrow and I didn't study for them. I will feel stressed because I feel like I can't pass them, which I probably could because I didn't study. But in reality, there's nothing actually preventing me from passing the exams, except for my own effort and determination to work on them. So stress is just a fear, and fear is just an emotion. With any other emotion, we can control it and override them, because we are the masters of our own emotions. And then lastly, we have this thing called fixation. Fixation on what? Fixation on results. We live in a very, very competitive society, where the difference between being rich and being poor may just be what college you get into. This, therefore, we fixate on results so much that we lose a meaning in the process. Life is not a mad dash from one destination to another. Life is a journey. We all start in the same place, we will all end up in the same place. It's how we get there, what we do in this process that defines life, that gives life its beauty, its meaning. But this fixation, the very fixation that we have itself, we start to just blind ourselves. We start to become donkeys with a carrot in front of our head. All we want to do is run towards it. And we never look aside to different avenues of life. Life is not about running along a hurdle, nor is it about running in one straight path until your legs are broken. It's about seeing what's around you and experiencing all the little possibilities. It is truly being one with the world around you. Therefore, this brings us to self-discovery. Self-discovery is a magical thing. Because in the very process of doing so, you explore the infinite possibilities we have, we possess, and we're capable of achieving. Self-discovery allows you to combat self-doubt and self-belief. It allows you to search for this thing called telos. And telos is a philosophy term used by philosophers like Aristotle to talk about a sense of purpose and what you want in life. But self-discovery is important because it allows you to define your own sense of purpose, not somebody else's. We're not living someone else's dream. We'd like to. We do enjoy, subconsciously almost, being told what we should do. We just enjoy being the hamster running on the wheel, not the one who runs away from everybody. One of my friends used to say, very often, that the person negligent enough to not define his or own definition of success, and instead strips one away from others, does not deserve success. On the other hand, one who is unafraid of pursuing his or own passions, and not afraid of failing, will, in the long run, end up being more successful. Now we have self-belief. Self-belief is not the opposite of self-doubt, although it may sound like it. Self-belief and self-doubt are merely two sides of the same coin. All you have to do to turn self-doubt into self-belief is flip the coin, is to change how you look at things a little bit. Turn that doubt you have into a motivation, a driving force that pushes you forward, that makes you want to achieve more, not one that leaves you stagnant. Self-belief is knowing that tomorrow can be better if you give it your all. And then after that, giving your all to do so, because we have the power. We always have more within us. Like our dean of student, Ms. White, always says to me, be your best self. You don't have to be the best student in this world. I probably will never. Many of us may never be the best student in this world, but we can be our best self, because there's always some area for us to improve at. We're not perfect creatures, we never will be. Perfection does not exist, for there will always be more room for us to improve. And that is why self-belief is important. That is why we must not be demoralized by our own shortcomings. And then, this comes back again to self-esteem, and again to Maslow's definition of self-actualization. I believe this is fallacy within his definition, because he said, in essence, that we are only born to fulfill one role and one role only. We only have one purpose in life. That's not true. I disagree with that. Because I feel like human limitation simply just does not exist. Human limitation is a false construct. It's a limitation we put upon ourselves to prevent ourselves from being complete, from being what we truly can be. Why can't we do this? Why can't we do this and this? Why can't we be more than one thing? Why do we always have to fulfill only one thing? Why do I only have to be a science guy if I don't also love humanities? Why do I have to fixate on one thing? Why do I have to pull myself in? We don't. We really don't. Human limitations do not exist. We can overcome them like our ancestors have numerous times to create what we have right now. This brings us to the end. Your future. What does your future hold? Future is scary to think about because it is so uncertain. But that is also the beauty of life itself. Life itself is very capricious. Any next moment, any next infinitesimally small change could end up changing everything around us. But that is not a fact to be feared, but rather one to be appreciated. Because in that notion, we realize that we ourselves have the power to change the world around us. even with our our smallest actions and smallest efforts. Therefore, be the writer of your own story. Pick up that pen, write your story how you want it to be. Steer your future in your own way. Don't follow anybody else. There's no need to. We're not born to all be like each other, or else the world will be boring. And I have this little story I want to share in the end. I used to be very cynical. I used to think that our world has too many problems, and I'm just simply too powerless, too ordinary to change anything. I'm just a simple high school kid. There's nothing special about me. But I still want better. I still want the world around me and myself to be better. By all means, what I have is good enough, so to say, but I want more. You can call it greed, but I call it ambition. And this very ambition is part of human nature that should never be concealed nor denied, because that's what gotten us here so far, this one. Therefore, I have learned to see the world keenly for what it is right now, but also see it for what it could be. It could be many more things. Everything could be better. And that is why now I'm standing right here today. This is a very testament to myself, to my own self-actualization, to fulfilling what I truly want to do in life. And I just do what I can to make the world around me a little bit better, if I could. At last, this is what I'll leave you with. Everybody wants to be happy, but what really is happiness? If happiness could take a physical form, what would it be like? I used to ask myself that a lot. When I was young, I thought it would be like ice cream, because it tastes good. Back in freshman year, I used to think it was a report card with straight A's, because that's supposedly what gives me happiness, right? Now I think of it a little bit differently. I think of it like glass. Happiness is glass. Like a glass prism, almost. Because it's transparent. Sometimes we forget that it exists because we can see through it and feel like there's nothing there. And it's also so fragile that our actions could just shatter it and be completely different. However, this glass prism is within each one of us. And all we have to do at times is just adjust our perspective, our viewing angle, just a little bit. Then we see this prism through a different light, and this different light will pass through it and shine and refract through a ray that will remind you not only of this glass prism's existence, but also how precious your memories have been, because they are the very things that make up this prism. They are the very things that make up your happiness. So one day I hope all of you can look back on your past and see not just a mere prism, but see a huge wall of glass, because your memories and what you have become so strong that it's no longer fragile or ignorable. It becomes the wall of glass, a wall of happiness. And that wall, within it, you can see a reflection of yourself. And I hope that self you see is someone who you saw once that you wanted to be. Tomorrow can always be better, as long as we have the determination to make it better. I never fear to pursue our own passion and be who we truly are. Thank you.